welcome. It's Steelers. Good evening and welcome. It's Steelers Hate Week. Sharona has taken the keys to the car away from Zach and is driving the going for two. And is driving the going for two bus tonight. Ignore the headbanging music in the background and all that smoke circulating around the tour bus. We're on a mission. Anyway, Steelers Hate Week, which means that we hate the Steelers and the Steelers pretend like this is a game that matters. It's Monday Night Football, so of course John Gruden will be sure to love him some burgers. Ha, ha, ha. You know that he and Mike Tirico are going to be grilling some burgers on Monday Night Football, much like they made that shake on this week's Monday Night Football because it was a blowout and the Panthers looked terrible, which I expect the Titans are going to be in a similar situation on Monday night, but we'll see how that goes. We all know that joke's not funny, but I had to do it, right? Let's see. So these two teams these two teams have met each other 76 times in histories, and that goes back to the time when the Tennessee Titans were good and were the Tennessee sort of good and were the Tennessee Oilers. The Titans have won 32 of those games, by the way, and the Pittsburgh Steelers have won 44. The Titans did win the last matchup. Who could forget the infamous safety game, the safety on the first play of the 2013 NFL football season? Darius Raynaud took a step backward from the half-yard line into the end zone, and that's how the Titans 2013 started. It's amazing that they were able to recover that and actually win that game. But, hey, they were kind of good last year as opposed to this year. But we have, we talked about the AFC Central last week with Phil. Man, that division kind of ruled. It was pretty great. The teams in it were pretty great. The Titans were good back when they played in the AFC Central. Of course, now the Titans have sucked since the NFL booted them out of the AFC Central, and now they are in the namby-pamby AFC South where everybody seems to suck except the Indianapolis Colts. But we're joined now by Dave, I believe, from Steelers Depot. He's going to be our frenemy this week, talking about the I've got some glitter going on here. Gonna have to do something about that. Dave, how are you? Dave, are you with us? Oh, we may not be able to hear Dave.
I see his icon.
Yeah, I can see your icon, Dave, but I can't hear you.
So can you do Google Plus audio only? I guess we'll find out, huh? Or you could ask really dumb questions. I could do the wah, wah, wah sound like the teacher in the Peanuts.
That's every week. We need to be a little bit different this week.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
We'll try to get Dave in here. We're having a little bit of some audio difficulties.
Technical difficulties.
I don't know, Dave, if you have, Dave's gone now. I was going to tell him, let me send him a message real quick. If he's got a headset or a mic, that might help us get him in here.
I see him, yeah.
Okay. Message sent. All right, well, it wouldn't be going for two without a few little technical issues, so we'll get Dave in here. There he is. Oh, wait, now you're unmuted. Dave, I bet we can hear you now.
Uh-oh.
No, you're muted again.
Oh, I see. I think it's the mute button's on. That's his button, right?
That's his button, though. I can't help him. I can't help him.
Cat.
Yeah.
Yeah. I sent you Rick's basically his Google Plus the name because it's Asylum Fantasy and they're both named Rick, so it's Fleeger Briggs is the Google Plus handle. He hasn't done this too either. Well, he's got draw, so maybe he'll draw his questions.
Or his answers. We got to get Dave in here because I got to ask him about Dan McCullers, who sounds like Dan's going to play Monday night. Kind of excited about that.
This week's Steelers fans are brought to you by their game plan against the Jets. Oh, Sorry, shouldn't ask that one there.
Yeah, we're having some, unfortunately, having some issues with Dave, but we'll try to get him in here. By the way, if you haven't checked out Steelers Depot, definitely do that. They've got some great content up there. I was able to listen to the – they did a podcast with Dave Beauclair, who writes for Hello. Dave.
Okay, I think I got you. I think I got this figured out now.
Awesome.
I'm sorry about that, guys.
No worries at all. I was just saying that I had a chance to listen to your podcast with Dave Beauclair today, and I was giving a big shout-out to your website. Excellent stuff on there. Excuse me. You guys are going to have to just forgive me tonight. I am recovering from the crud, so I'm going to be a little coffee. But, and Dave, I should have told you, we're adults here. We allow beverages. So
we kind of require it, don't we?
I'm a recovered alcoholic, so I'm going to be drinking.
This is the second time we've done that. So good for you.
You're not offending me at all.
Good for you, Dave. Proud of you for that. So, all right, let's talk about the game. I was just talking about last year's game. It's amazing that the Titans were able to actually win that one, recovering from that safety. And it was a slobber knocker like you would expect, you know, from a Titans-Steelers game. What is the word up in Pittsburgh about this game? What's the feeling among Steelers fans? Do they consider the Titans a threat at all this year?
Well, absolutely. I mean, look how we've played against teams dating back to 2012 with a sub-500 record at the time that we play them. You know, the Jets are a perfect example of that last week. They were 1-8 entering that game. The Steelers have lost to the Buccaneers earlier in the season. They, you know, that was the Buccaneers' only win. They had trouble with the Jaguars earlier in the season. And they lost to an 0 at the time in week 2, an 0-1 Baltimore Ravens team. So, you know, like I said, going back to 2012, the Steelers have struggled with teams that technically they should probably beat when you look at them on paper. And but, you know, then they turn around. They have the three-game stretch like they had against the Houston Texans, the Baltimore Ravens, and the Indianapolis Colts. So to be honest with you, if you ask any Steelers fan, if they're objective at all, they're going to tell you they don't know what to expect coming into this game. Now, the Titans are starting a rookie quarterback in Zach Mettenberger, and Dick LeBeau has had success during his career dating back to 2004 against rookie quarterbacks. In fact, only two rookie quarterbacks have beaten him since that time. So, look, that, you know, no Steelers fan is going to tell you that this is going to be a cakewalk game.
Yeah, great answer there. You know, I would say it's been kind of a weird year for the Steelers. Which Steelers team is going to show up this week, Dave?
I wish I could tell you. You know, I really do. This is a Steelers team that needs to start getting back to being able to run the football again. The last couple of weeks, they haven't had.
Well, they should be successful against the Titans.
Well, you know, when you look at the Titans on tape, and I've gone back and looked at the last few games of the Titans, and you would think, you know, statistics and the tape tell you that you know, they should be able to run between the tackles against the Titans. And if they're able to do that early on in the game, then that should set up some play action and then, you know, hopefully some deep balls to Martavis Bryant or Antonio Brown. So, you know, as long as the Steelers don't turn the football over, look, they turned the football over 4 times against the Jets, and you're not going to beat any team in the NFL if you turn the football over that many times.
Yeah, you know, the Titans have had some turnover issues. Zach Mettenberger throwing an interception. I believe he also there was a fumble too. Mixed returns on him. But I want to ask you about your injury report and some of your players. I am so disappointed that I'm not going to get to see Ryan Shazier play. How big is his loss?
Well, he's missed quite a few games this season. First, it was a sprained knee. They get him back, and then, you know, halfway through the game that they got him back, he turns an ankle. So this will be the second consecutive game now that he's missed with that. It's really hard to tell. You know, he showed some bright spots in the games that he's dressed for this year. But, you know, he just can't stay on the field. Luckily, they have two younger linebackers in Sean Spence and Vince Williams, who have both been rotating into games alongside Lawrence Timmons, and filling that role. So not only will they not have him, Troy Polamalu is going to miss this game as well, too. This is the second consecutive game that he'll miss. He sprained.
Big names on the injury report.
Yeah, Polamalu, and then, of course, Ike Taylor has been out since week three with that broken forearm of his. They hope to get him back after the bye week. So those are three guys that are out. Two of the young safeties, the backup safeties that really help out on special teams, talking about Shamarco Thomas and Ross Ventrone. Both of those guys entered the week listed as really as questionable, so we'll have to watch their status. And the Steelers starting nose tackle, Steve McClendon, has been bothered by a shoulder a couple of times this year. He's kind of iffy right now to start the week two with that shoulder once again, so we're going to have to watch the injury report as the week progresses here.
Yeah, let me interject right now and ask you. I was listening to the podcast, and of course I knew that there were some issues there. It sounds like Dan McCullers might play a little bit Monday night. How's Dan doing? Looks like he's only played maybe in one game this year. And the second part to that question is whether or not the Steelers miss Al Woods. And I was laughing because Zach is the yin to my yang. He added a who after that question.
Well, the thing with McCullers, he's dressed for three games now. He's only played about 20, right around roughly 20-something snaps. He's a big kid, and look, for him to even be seeing playing time right now in the Steelers' defense is pretty incredible, because that's just something for a rookie in a Dick LeBeau defense that doesn't happen. Now, whether or not McCullers dresses for the game against the Titans Monday night might come down to whether or not Steve McClendon is able to go, because the Steelers normally only dress five defensive linemen if they have a full complement, of healthy players. Now, with the injury report we just said, if the injury report's full and that causes, the inactive list to be filled up by those inactive players, then you could see a repeat of what happened last week in the game against the Jets, where the Steelers pretty much had to dress six defensive linemen because they had so many guys on the injury report that were inactive. So Dan, he's coming along. It's hard to draw any hard conclusions because he's played so few snaps.
I never thought he would make it. I'm a Tennessee alumnus. I am very familiar with Dan. I never thought he'd make an NFL squad. So that he's actually on the 53 is amazing to me.
Well, let me tell you, I was hard to, after McCullers was drafted, you go back and you looked at his tape from his time at Tennessee there. I doubted he was going to make it as well, too, because he was a guy that really seemed slow off the ball, kind of lethargic. He came off the ball high, and that allowed,
terrible technique.
Yeah, some smaller guards to get up underneath him. So just because he has had the size, it looked on tape. He looked every bit of a sixth-round draft pick. Let's put it to you that way. But I've got to admit, he really has come around, and he's made a couple of nice plays in a few snaps that he has played so far. And you asked me about Al Woods. I thought Al Woods was going to be a slam dunk to re-sign during the offseason.
I thought a lot of people did.
I really did. Now, not because I thought he was a starter quality, but I thought the Steelers had him a couple of years on the roster and spent time developing him to kind of be a rotated in defensive end slash nose tackle. And, I thought he was a slam dunk to re-sign during the offseason. It was a bit of a surprise right there kind of early on in free agency when he did sign with the Titans. And, evidently he's not getting a whole heck of a lot of playing time over in Tennessee. Yeah. But he is
played a little bit more this past weekend than he has, but yeah.
Yeah, so he is getting in the rotation over there. But see, because they lost Al Woods, they had to go out and replace him. So they had to sign free agent Cam Thomas, who started his career with the San Diego Chargers. And let me tell you, Cam Thomas really has started a lot of games this year at left defensive end.
Oh, yeah? Okay.
He has backed up nose tackle earlier in the season to Steve McLennan, and he has not played well at all. So, you know, if you ask any Steelers fan, they would gladly probably right now at this moment give you Cam Thomas to have Al Woods back. But, you know, Al Woods gave the Steelers some good snaps over the years, and you know, we always like to see former Steelers do well.
Dave, we're getting you some backup in here. We got another Steelers guy in here to back you up. We don't want to leave you outnumbered. I think the thing about Al Woods, you know, he might actually be playing a little bit more, except that Sammy Lee Hill has really exceeded expectations and is playing very well at the nose tackle position. And they've got two excellent defensive ends in Jarrell Casey and Rapati. I'm going to mispronounce his last name because Petoa Tua. I actually got it right.
It's not like you're clearing your throat for it to be right.
I'm so bad with names, but, you know, he was a good defensive end in their 4-3, but, you know, his natural position is an end in that 3-4, and he's really been very good this year for the Titans. So I know Zach, I don't want to dominate the conversation. I know Zach wants to ask some questions.
Well, I have, we added Rick on here from the Asylum Fantasy Podcast to join in the Steelers talk. We do have a bet going on for this week's game. So, Rick, have you been able to procure any icy light with mango for this week's game? I do see him, but maybe I haven't heard him yet.
While we're getting Rick set up, I want to ask Dave real quick about Mike Munchak seems to be doing an excellent job up in Pittsburgh. How do Pittsburgh Steelers fans feel about him? And I want to get your thoughts on Ken Whisenhunt.
Well, boy, you couldn't be more excited when it was announced that the Steelers were going to get Mike Munchak as offensive line coach. Really, that was a position coach that they needed. That they had a guy I'm drawing a blank here on his name. Prior to him was only with the Steelers for one season. Didn't do a good job at all. Look, the Steelers have a lot of draft picks invested in their offensive line. Dating back to, and high draft picks at that. Marquise Pouncey when he was in the first round there. Mm-hmm. And the draft picks really haven't lived up to the expectations, talking about Marcus Gilbert, talking about David DeCastro, Mike Adams. Now we're starting to see some development in there. Up until really this last game against the Jets, there was a string of about three or four games right in a row there where the offensive line really played well together. So we kind of expect that to continue. But, a Hall of Famer and Mike Munchak, his resume speaks for itself. And the Steelers are lucky to have him. And as far as Ken Whisenhunt goes, Ken was the offensive coordinator with the Steelers way back in 2004. He was Ben Roethlisberger's first offensive coordinator when he came into the league. So, he gets some credit in helping develop Ben Roethlisberger in those early years there. And I heard Whisenhunt's press conference the other day talking. He was asked to compare Roethlisberger to Mettenberger, and he said, in so many words, he wasn't going to do that.
It's an unfair comparison. It is for both guys, really.
Right, and I respect Ken Whisenhunt. Following him around, time with the San Diego, of course, in Arizona there, and look, he's got his hands full over there in Tennessee right now. You're trying to get younger and you're trying to get people to kind of fit that scheme right now, especially on the defensive side of football, because you brought in Ray Horton, who, of course, spent time on the Steelers coaching staff several years ago, and he switched to that 3-4. And as I was talking with David Beauclair today on our podcast, it's probably going to take another draft for the Titans to get some personnel that really does fit that scheme perfectly.
Yeah, I heard you guys talking about that. I know you're going to have to go in a minute, Dave. Just real quick, I agree with Dave Beauclair about Cam Wembley is a veteran guy, and you're fortunate that you have a guy like that who can step in and man that that right off outside linebacker position. They do have Sean Phillips, behind him. Inexplicably traded away Akeem Ayers, who actually probably should be playing there, but that's another story in and of itself. But they're going to have to replace him. They need an elite pass rusher. There's just absolutely no question, but that they need an elite pass rusher. They need another playmaker in their defense. And if they can get that, I think that defense is going, and the secondary is really struggling, particularly at times in the safety position. And you've already talked about Bleedy Ray with Dave Beauclair. You know, if poor Bleedy had better over the top safety help, he would be a lot better, but he doesn't have any. Mike Griffin is really struggling there, and so it's just, you know, I'm really worried to see what Antonio Brown and Martavis Bryant are going to do.
Well, yeah, well, you know, you got a good corner over there on the other side that I think is going to spend most of his night covering Antonio Brown. But you know, look, teams that have played the Steelers this year have tried to take Antonio Brown out of the game plan, you know, with bracket coverages, and nobody's been able to do it yet. You know, even with putting a safety up over the top there. So even if the Titans do try to take Antonio Brown away, more than anything, what the Titans need to do is just try to limit him after the catch.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Go ahead and let him get his 7, 8, 9 catches. But what's killing teams this year is Antonio Brown breaking off the big runs after the catch. And if the Titans can limit that, can limit the explosive plays, you know, I think they're going to be in a better shape. But on the flip side, when you have Bleedy over there on the other side, I think that's where the Steelers might try to attack with either Marcus Wheaton, with rookie Martavis Bryant, who really, since he's dressed the last handful of games, boy, already 6 touchdowns.
He is amazing. He's truly amazing.
And he's a very, very raw route runner. He really, they're trying to bring him along slow, but I wouldn't be surprised if they tried to attack your young corner on that other side over there.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting you say that. The Titans did that against Kansas City, and that's the only game that they were really successful at it. You know, they were kind of lucky in the Jaguars game to win that. Dave, thanks for joining us. Tell everybody where they can find you on Twitter, and give a big shout-out to your website.
Yeah, you can follow me on Twitter at Steelers Depot. You can visit the website, SteelersDepot.com. We do a podcast. 5 years old now, our podcast is. We do 3 episodes of the podcast a week. It's carried on the Steelers official website, on Steelers.com, on Steelers Nation Radio as well, too. So good luck to you guys this week, and we'll
Here's
see.
Here's to a good game, no injuries.
Yeah, we'll see which Steelers team shows up.
All right, thanks, All right. Dave.
Thanks for having me.
All right,
so Rick, you online. We got you. I see you.
No, I think so. How do I sound?
You sound wonderful, and I love the hat.
You sound like you might be from Pittsburgh.
Yeah, we all sort of sound Amish up here.
That's pretty cool. So have you been able to, you're in the local Pittsburgh area, right, aren't you?
Yeah, about 40 miles north, so close as I want to be anyhow.
Now, have you actually seen the Iron City light with Mango stores?
I did a while ago. I've been looking for it because I need to figure a way to get it shipped down south here very soon. It's been a chore. Apparently, it wasn't a big seller. I'm surprised, but it wasn't a big seller. But we'll get it down to you. Don't worry.
Yeah, that was the bet that we made, and I swear we made this like when the schedule came out. You know, Titans, Steelers, and the loser is going to drink a warm Iron City light with Mango. Because Iron City Mango just seems like the exact opposite of what a kind of a blue-collar beer would be. So in a way, we're both going to be losers, as it goes. But it's odd because initially I was like, well, I'll just leave it outside. Now I'm like, I better put it inside because it's going to be really freaking cold that night.
Yeah, I'm stunned this was ever created. I don't know where it came about. Iron City at its best is swill. When you start putting fruit in it, it's just a total disaster.
I'm drinking a local beer.
Oh, I got a Happen Harry's, all right?
Happen Harry's, Tennessee Lager.
No mango in it, I hope.
Yeah. Of course, I have a chocolate stout. I don't know if that's good or bad.
You drink such girly beers, Zach.
Man, ouch. It hurts so much.
Mango, chocolate. Nothing wrong with that, I'm just saying.
So, Rick, there's been talk, you know, over the years with Mike Tomlin. For some reason, the team just has trouble being focused from week to week. What is that all about? Because you almost could predict that they're going to struggle against the Jets just because they've done so well the last 2 weeks.
Yeah, boy, going back, this year, bottom line, I don't think this team's very good. They're defensively, especially, that secondary is horrendous. You expect more from the offense. I do know we talked about last week on our show, for whatever reason, if you go back, and I don't have the statistics in front of me, the Meadowlands has been a house of horrors for that Steelers team. They really struggle up there historically. I believe 2 years ago, maybe 3 years ago, they'd won up there, and it was the first time in over 15 or 20 years. They struggle there. I think it's, you know, the big news around here, the big talk has always been Tomlin is too much of a player's coach. And a game like the Ravens game, you know, tends to self-motivate the players. I don't think Mike Tomlin is the kind of coach that gets this team ready, gets this team motivated. I can't explain it, and it's been like this for a few years now, where they get up for the big games, and games you expect them to win, games they should walk away from, they struggle. Now, oftentimes they win them. You don't usually go out and get trucked by Cleveland like they did a few weeks ago. And basically, as far as I'm concerned, get blown out by the Jets. The score didn't indicate how badly they got beaten. I wish I could explain it. I think it's a Tomlin problem. I think it's a Todd Haley problem. It's a coaching staff. It's a coaching issue for me.
I wanted to ask Dave about this. You know, we talked a little bit about Ken Whisenhunt, and of course now Todd Haley is the offensive coordinator that Steelers fans love to hate. What are your thoughts on Todd Haley as an offensive coordinator?
Well, it's starting to come along. Obviously, we didn't like how it started. Whatever this rift was, be it made up by the media or not, between him and Ben Roethlisberger when he got here, you've seen flashes of it. My frustration with him personally, I think this is a guy who tends to go to the well just too many times. If I see one more slip screen to Antonio Brown on third and long, I may become a Titans fan. That may be what I have to do.
Oh, well, you'll need lots and lots of beer for that.
It's a real lack of creativity, and you talk about Ken Whisenhunt. I think that's what set him apart. He had less weapons when he was here in Pittsburgh, but he knew when to pull the trigger. He had trick plays. He had a very interesting offense. He could run it straight up. He could sprinkle this other stuff in. Haley seems to latch on to one thing. Recently, it's been this wide receiver screen and won't let it go. He tends to he's stuck in a rut. But is what it seems to me. And it looked good for a couple weeks. You got all these weapons around him. You've got what Le'Veon Bell and Antonio Brown are doing, the addition of Martavis Bryant. And I just don't think he's being as creative as he could be with that offense.
Yeah, it's been a nice turnaround for Le'Veon Bell. I know it's for some reason last year, Munchak just couldn't get the offensive line to block against the 3-4. Since they're going against a 3-4 D in their own building, you think they're more prepared for that kind of defense, especially since a lot of the teams in the AFC North do that?
Well, it's something you're seeing in practice every day. You think they should be ready for it. You know, the offensive line has improved a little bit. I think, you know, they've struggled. You have seen it in practice every day. It certainly should be a benefit, although it hasn't really panned out that way.
So what do you think? How do you feel it's going to go on Monday? Or you think there's just a wide variety of possibilities?
It's going to be closer than it should be. I think I know that. And yeah, I wish I had the guts to sit here and tell you I think the Titans are going to win this game. I think the difference is, as bad as that defense has been, I think what it comes down to is still historically Dick LeBeau feasts on rookie quarterbacks. And I think that's what makes the difference. Just a lack of weapons on the offensive side for Tennessee. I don't think you're going to see the big offensive explosion. The Steelers will play down to an opponent, and that's what you're going to see. It's going to be unnecessarily close, but I think they find a way coming off that Jets debacle. Had they beat the Jets, I think I would have the guts to pick the Titans here, but I think the Steelers find a way to get it done in the end.
Yeah, I think this is the one team the Titans actually had like a winning streak against. In fact, my uncle, who's originally from Pittsburgh, decided not to come to this game because he's tired of watching the Steelers lose.
I wish. You know, it makes me sad that the Titans are struggling and have struggled the last couple years. You know, I'm like a lot of Pittsburghers. Obviously, I didn't like the Browns years ago. Nobody likes the Ravens. I don't even think the Ravens like the Ravens. But back in the old divisional days, this Tennessee team, this is a team I considered the real rivalry. This was the game I looked most forward to. Going back to Steve McNair and Eddie George and those guys. I hated those Tennessee teams when they were good and the Steelers were winning and they were both playoff teams. That was a rivalry I looked forward to. Hated seeing the division get broke up and hate to see the Titans struggling. This is a game I could get pumped up for generally.
Yeah, I miss the AFC Central. I was just saying earlier on the podcast that since the Titans got kicked out and it became the AFC North and they had to go to the putrid AFC South, they have largely sucked.
Yeah, it's struggling. It's a different, and you wonder, you know, it's a totally different style of play down there in that South. You wonder if maybe it's been the issue of adjusting to that, where that, and then the AFC North's changing. Cincinnati's trying to make it a ground or an air show. The Steelers are trying to do it. I think the league's changing in general, but I think they were built to compete in that old AFC Central, and moving to the South probably has been a struggle for them.
Well, I think the AFC Central division was perfect for Fisher Ball. And, you know, Jeff Fisher believed in ball control.
Right.
A little bit too much so, and which is another story. But, yeah, you know, the league is changing, but I still think that it's a ball control league, and teams that are successful controlling it are going to be successful.
Right, and it – I think you see it in what Seattle did last year. That's what they did. You know, they got some gimmick to their offense. But you see a Steelers team, and that's why I thought the Steelers would be better. The addition of Le'Veon Bell, you know, all the things he can do in the passing game, he is able to run between the tackles a little bit. You got LeGarrette Blount able to run the ball. But it seems like unless the Roethlisberger's thrown for 45, 50 times for 350 yards a game, they're not successful. And I think maybe back to the Todd Haley question, that might be one of the biggest frustrations there.
How many touches is Le'Veon Bell seeing per game?
Well, I mean, what, he's got about 162 carries to this point. Now, let me look up his reception numbers here real quick. He's right up there in the top 10 of the team as well. Of course, I can't find it here. Right? Oh, yeah, number two on the team. He's got 59 receptions already. I mean, he's a big part of this offense.
Yeah, I knew that he was he's like the second leading receiver because I was looking to see what Bryant's stats were.
Yeah, Le'Veon's got 66 targets. He's caught 55 of them. He's ahead of Marcus Wheaton, ahead of Heath Miller. Martavis Bryant's leapfrogged everybody. Le'Veon Bell's in more than half the snaps right now.
Hey, speaking of Wheaton, what's the prognosis for him? Is he going to be the lost guy out?
I really think so. This is a guy, boy, I had high hopes for him. You know, if nothing else in that Mike Wallace role from a few years ago, I think Antonio Brown being the perfect mix of a downhill threat, but also a possession guy, a guy who can touch the ball 10, 11 times. And Martavis Bryant has come in and done what we expected out of Marcus Wheaton. This is what we wanted to see out of Wheaton, and Bryant's that guy. And going back to when Plaxico Burress left years and years ago, Bryant's the guy that Ben Roethlisberger's been screaming for. He wants a good hands guy. He wants a downfield guy, and he wanted that tall guy. Wheaton a little bit undersized. He's good in space if he's got room. I think he flourishes a little more now. He's better in that third role. He needs an Antonio Brown and a Martavis Bryant clearing things out for him. You know, I think Wheaton does all right. You know, Lance Moore's not going to be around too long. You know, Justin Miller. I mean, some of these guys. I think Wheaton will be fine, but as far as fantasy relevancy and big numbers, I don't think you're going to see it. I think Bryant has taken that role already, and you see Wheaton just as a complimentary downfield piece.
Mm-hmm. What about Heath Miller? How much longer is he going to play?
Well, it's nice to see. It seems like he's back fully healthy finally from that ACL. I don't think he was ever truly healthy this year. You know, his role has changed. He started out as that blocking tight end. He sort of evolved into a favorite target of Ben's in recent years. And I think with the additions of Le'Veon Bell and some of the other guys, I think similar to what you're seeing out of Jason Witten in Dallas, as their offenses are changing, you see him more in a blocking role. I mean, I think he could have three or four more years in him in that role. He's not going to He's not going to put up 67 receptions. You're not going to see that out of him. He's their best blocker, and I think he's the key piece on that offensive line in the offense they're trying to run right now.
He's a throwback two-way guy, kind of like Delanie Walker, right?
Delanie Walker, who's probably not going to play Monday night. In fact, I'd be willing to bet he's not playing Monday night.
Well, that's terrible news for fantasy owners. This is a kid on the rise and one of your few, few real fantasy-relevant guys in Tennessee right now.
Yeah, it's kind of sad.
Pretty much their offensive MVP, yeah. So you see the Steelers focusing pretty much on defense in the future in their draft, because it does seem like they're trying to basically retool.
Yeah, unfortunately, I think they have the last three or four years, and it just hasn't worked out. Yeah, this reputation the Steelers have of being a good drafting team, it hasn't panned out lately. I think some early bust, the jury's still out on Shazier. He hasn't been able to stay healthy. He's looked good so far this year. Historically, I think you got to go back to Chad Scott for a first-round corner, and the biggest problem for this team, even through the playoff years and the Super Bowl years, I think was a lack of good corner talent. They got lucky with Ike Taylor. Obviously he's hurt. Before he got hurt, he's on the downside of his career. He's lost a step. I think to compete in today's NFL, they're going to have to start focusing on that secondary. Paul Amalu, he can't have another year or two left in him. And I think if you watch him, he's lost a step and a half. He's a shell of what he once was. He's not the playmaker. I think the problem when you look at Troy Polamalu is what frustrates me is, if you watch now, you see him horrifically out of position all the time. What you need to know is 3 years ago, he was horrifically out of position on every play, too, trying to make the big play. But he had the speed and the wherewithal to get back into the play in time. He doesn't have that anymore, and you just see him taking terrible angles. I think the linebacker core will be okay if they keep this 3-4 intact, this Dick LeBeau defense.
What's up with Jarvis Jones? How's he doing?
Not a lot of updates. They've sort of gone quiet on him. He should be back soon. I believe it was a 6 or an 8 week injury. No talk of him coming back anytime soon.
They want him back, does it?
I'm sorry?
Doesn't really sound like they care whether he comes back or not.
No, you don't hear his name brought up. And a guy, for them, a fairly high first-round pick. I'd like to see the kid get the opportunity. I have to wonder, Dick LeBeau's pushing 107 now, if I'm not mistaken. There was always talk way back to when Mike Tomlin was hired. He wanted to put in that 4-3 defense, and this was all just a tribute to Dick LeBeau. I don't think he thought he'd stick around this long. So you almost wonder if they're building this defense for something else down the road.
That's true. See, what you going to be drinking on Monday for this game?
I don't know. I might keep it simple. Just buy some garbage Miller Lite or something. It's something I can drink about 45 of, because this is the type of game where they're going to look terrible and I'm going to get flustered, and so I want to be able to consistently do it. If I get that fancy stuff you're drinking with the chocolate, and it looks like motor oil from where I'm sitting here, you can only drink so many of those. And I want to be able to consistently go throughout the night.
I understand.
Well, I'm going to be drinking some overpriced stadium something.
So we'll both be at the game. Oh, man, that's going to be rough. Yeah, I just remember, I didn't even think about it, really, man. I was thinking about the last few games, like the Thursday night game 2 years ago. But I didn't remember until tonight. The last Titans home playoff win was against the Steelers, and it was freaking cold, and the sun went down. We had that whole missed field goal fiasco. And the sad part is I wasn't even engaged yet, and I'm just celebrating my 11th wedding anniversary. And guess who hasn't won another playoff game since? So that's been a rough time for us.
Yeah, that's been a long time, but you're right. Yeah, I remember that field goal, that whole debacle, and I believe the uncalled penalty at the end, or the penalty that should have been called. I don't remember exactly how it went. I think it's cold down there in Tennessee.
It's cold as math right now.
Not Pittsburgh cold.
It is like 27 degrees right now.
Oh, you win. You're beating us. We're at a balmy 35 right now.
I might be exaggerating just a little bit. It was like 36 degrees when I came downstairs to turn the fireplace on so I wouldn't freeze doing this.
Another year of polar vortex, apparently.
Yeah, I heard, I think the high on Monday in Nashville is supposed to be like 40, so there you go. So we're not going to have any sun, because that playoff game, it started sunny, and then the sun went down, and that's when it got rough. But anyway, Rick, well, thank you for coming on the show. If you want to tell us about, you know, where to find you on Twitter and about your podcast and all that good stuff.
Sure. Thanks for having me on. You can check us out on Twitter at Asylum Football, our website. You can find all our shows there, asylumfantasysports.com. We do a live show Thursdays at 7 o'clock Eastern on our website and Blog Talk Radio. We also do a show Sunday mornings, 10 a.m. It's a lineup call-in show, 10 o'clock on Blog Talk Radio on our website. And you can also check us out. We are on the Fantasy Sports Network. That's at fantasysportsnetwork.com. I don't think they're on any outlets down your way. I know in the New York area they're on Cablevision, Channel 147. It's all across Canada. It's a great network. Check that out, fantasysportsnetwork.com. We're on there Saturdays at 1 o'clock Eastern. Our show airs there, and that's an episode of the show you won't find on our website. So check it out.
All right, thanks. It's nice meeting you.
All right, thanks.
Find some kind of Iron City Light with mango substitute. I will drink something like that after the game if they lose, and we'll probably put it on YouTube, and it'll be viral and all that good stuff.
All right, it will be on its way. Thanks for having me. Good luck this week.
See ya.
Well, thanks, Rick. My gosh. Well, that was good. We got a lot of talk.
I am disappointed in you, Zach.
What? What about who?
Wore my Javon Curse jersey just for terrible towel talk.
Oh, yeah. I sadly couldn't find it. It's in the house somewhere. I have a picture of my cat sleeping on it. So he's actually sleeping on the Pac-Man jersey. Now, I want to know if you're in with me on this. This is something that I think it was Jimmy Morris, and it was Ricky, and I think Josh Gunnels got involved. Wear your embarrassing Titans jersey to the Monday Night Football game. That's the theme we have going.
I have to wear a Chris Johnson jersey?
You could probably go with Randy Moss. That'd be a good one. I have my Pac-Man.
That's not embarrassing. That's awesome.
I have, it was embarrassing while I was there, yeah. It's like, Rand University got zero touchdowns playing for the Titans. Good times.
You know what I'm going to wear. This is not even a discussion.
So you are going to the game, right?
I'm probably going to the game.
Because you can get a ticket for like $2, I'm sure. Unless a bunch of Yinzas are getting the tickets. Yinzas from Pittsburgh. Yeah, so I'm going to be coming up on Saturday. I'm going to be watching Missouri play Texas A&M. We've already set it up. I'm going to the Missouri-Tennessee game. And if Georgia loses and Florida wins, and if Missouri wins next week, they win the East again, which is crazy.
It's just crazy.
It's
going to be a photo finish in the SEC this year.
Exactly. So tell me, since I didn't see it, what did the offense look like when it was actually good last week? Like, how did those first couple drives look?
It looked good. They were throwing the ball long. They were running the ball. Mettenberger looked comfortable and confident. And, a lot of things happen. You know, he got rattled. They lost Dexter McCluster, which was unfortunate. And then, of course, a little bit later, Delaney Walker. And once those two guys went out, the wheels just fell off the offense. You know, I'm critical of some of the things that the coaching staff does. But with the offensive line struggling, you know, like they are, if you're not good in the trenches, you're just not going to be a good football game. They're a football team, and they're not good along the offensive line. Michael Orr got abused. The offensive line is struggling this year.
Yeah, that's one thing. You know, we have this kind of thread going from the Munchak era. And it seemed like during the Munchak era that other teams adjusted to the Titans well. I don't even know if Jeff Fisher did this very well. But it seems like the same thing's happening. It's almost like they had the first 15 plays scripted, and after that they were in trouble. Plus, you could tell it was a Delanie Walker kind of offensive plan, because even in the third and fourth quarters, because those are the parts of the game I got to see, he was targeting Chase Kaufman a lot, and I'm like, why are you targeting, you know, basically our fourth string off the street tight end?
He's not reading the very once the midpoint of the second quarter hit, he basically lost any ability to see the field.
Yeah, he's probably not doing a lot of reads, and we're still dealing with a sixth round rookie who probably didn't get a lot of reps until the last couple of weeks. Yeah. And even though he got a lot of reps that probably helped him during the bye week, he's still, you know, that young quarterback. It's going to be hard to say how he'll end up doing. So why on earth is Sean Green still getting important touches? Every other team in the NFL takes their running back out when he has one fumble, but Sean Green, nah, he's good. He's fine.
If you can explain or understand the running back usage, you're a much better football mind than me.
Well, I just saw it was the same as the Texans game. There's a lot of Leon Washington on, like, third and long screen passes. I'm like, okay. Poor man's Dexter McCluster, I guess. I don't know.
Well, I think the explanation is that he's their best pass blocking back. And so he's the check down option because he's in there because he can actually try to help this woeful offensive line protect their quarterback, who is probably in a third and long situation. You would think that he might be looking to throw the ball, though they seem to love them some draw plays on third and long.
Yeah, the draw or the screen pass, that was like the Marty Schottenheimer special. Third and long, that was pretty much what they would do. Plus, I think it's smart to just tell the rookie, like, third and long, just dump it off.
And, you know, and in their defense, you see Sankey doing some nice things, and then you see him look completely clueless in pass protection at times Sunday, and you're like, ooh, okay. You know, so, I mean, it's, they're just a mess. I mean, they are just a mess.
And it's also tough because you're seeing all these, like, rookie wide receivers just instantly be good. And, like, I would say, what, 8 rookie wide receivers have had, like, 100-yard games so far. And it doesn't seem like Justin Hunter is quite getting it in year two. And Bishop Sankey definitely isn't, you know, ready for that full-time role yet. Maybe he'll pick it up next
year. Well, Justin Hunter had, what, 2, maybe 3 targets?
Yep.
On.
I heard a sound. It's not not the big one, is it?
I have no idea what's up with all that. I don't even know what that was.
Ghost in the podcast room. All right.
Woohoo! There's a party down here.
It's a party.
So anyway, I completely lost my train of thought on that, but yeah.
See, I wouldn't. You know, it's every year, it's an annual thing. Second half of the year, the Titans aren't good, so you don't really want to go to the games. But is this Steelers game? And I'd say there's family, but usually for the Steelers game, we have like half a dozen people come down. This year, we have like 1. So actually 3. My cousin's bringing his kids. I wonder if they'll actually go to the games. It's going to be kind of late and kind of freezing. In fact, I think for the playoff game, my uncle and cousin got like club seats that were super expensive just because they were indoors. And
pussies.
They had a nice bar. There you go. So Nashville, exactly. Monday Night Football. By the way, everybody gets prime time. Ooh, and then the Titans and Jaguars are playing on Thursday night in a few weeks. That's going to be good.
Phew.
It seems like, and this goes for fantasy as well, there have just been some amazing blowouts. Like, all of the primetime games last week were just blowouts, and they weren't even close to begin with. And if you don't get that Aaron Rodgers or Jordy Nelson kind of performance in your team, you're totally screwed. So, yeah, if you're starting somebody like Jeremy Hill, you're feeling kind of rough. And that's how it's been lately. Like, the teams It's almost like college football. Like, the teams just, the motivation isn't there, and they kind of end up getting pounded like the Bears did on Sunday night. And I'm hoping that's not the way it goes with the Titans. Because I can't really blame the defense for kind of falling apart in the second half, because they just were on the field the entire second half.
They were so tired. They had one first down
in the second half. I mean, they just punted and they punted and punted.
They had one first down in the second quarter. They went an entire third quarter without having a first down, and then they did not get another first down until late in the game.
Yeah, I remember it was like a screen pass to Jackie Battle. Remember Jackie Battle? He was on the field. Woo! And he had to break.
Why do they insist on putting Carl Klug in on offense? Play the fucking guy on defense, you nutcase.
Yeah, it's a
French. I'm so pissed about that.
Yeah, it's a tough lineup. Like, they need that outside linebacker who can blitz the quarterback and get the rush. And besides Jarrell Casey, like, in the first half of the game, they don't get the rush. And that's the whole key against the Steelers. Like, when they beat the Steelers in that big showdown in 2008, they sacked Roethlisberger like 5 times. I mean, they just were all over him. And if he doesn't break that tackle when the guy gets wide open downfield, then you're okay. But other than that, so it's going to be a tough one. It's going to be a tough game. But that's okay. See, there are other teams in the NFL. I think we'll skip the whole what other division we will root for this week, since we did a little extra Know Your Enemy time. But what do you think about the NFC like playoff picture? Like, right now, between the Cardinals, the Eagles, the Seahawks, the Cowboys, the Lions, and the Packers, one of those teams can't make the playoffs. So how's that going to work out in the NFC?
Well, I think that you can't. I like a lot of things that the Cardinals are doing, but I don't think that a Drew Stanton-led Cardinals team can get the job done. I'm sorry. I think that he's a journeyman backup, trying to replace, and then they've got weapons. So I just don't know about the Cowboys. How many teams with a winning record have they actually beaten? I think maybe one or two. The 49ers are inconsistent. I think that it's still entirely possible the Seattle Seahawks are going to come out of that.
I'm kind of intrigued.
But they're injured. I mean, they're so injured that, it may actually end up being the Eagles and Mark Sanchez, which would just drive everybody nuts.
I know. Hey, I was all like, in fantasy, I'm like, Sanchez is good. I picked him up in a league with 2-quarterback league, and he had a good, a solid week. So he worked out. And I was kind of ticked because I had a high waiver priority last week, and I ended up picking up Adrian Peterson instead, so we'll see how that goes. But yeah, because this week I had Zach Mettenberger was my only quarterback, so I picked up Josh McCown. So we'll see.
Because
how that goes.
Of a glitch in one of my fantasy football leagues that I think we've gotten fixed now. I need to check on that. The only available quarterback I had that I could play was Jake Locker.
Well, I hope you can pick somebody up.
Well, I can now. I could not make any transaction.
John Hill, perhaps? That's the funny thing. Now, this is what gets me.
What's up with that?
We have retread.
Jeff Fisher, right?
We have retread coaches with young quarterbacks, and they're switching back to the veteran. Like, the Bucks are going with Josh McCown, who's like 39 years old. Almost as old as me. Gosh, that's old. And then we have the Rams. Now, Austin Davis looked feisty early on, but he's kind of turned a pumpkin. Of course, you know why he's turned to a pumpkin? Look at all the receivers that the Rams have. It's hilarious. I saw somebody saying, oh, the Rams got to draft a receiver in the first round next year. I'm like, they've used like 12 picks on wide receivers in the last like 5 years, and they've all been bad, except Brian Quick looks like he might be okay. But he's injured.
Yeah, he's on injured reserve.
So they're putting Sean Hill back in there, which is only helping me in one league where I'm desperate need of picking up a bye week quarterback. But yeah, it's a not fun time, because we're getting It's bizarre. This is it. Last week of bye weeks. The last 2 weeks have been particularly painful with six teams off. I don't know what we're going to do when we're back to, like, full strength, because it hasn't been since week three. I mean, it's just not, it's not a world we're used to.
Bye weeks have become insane anymore. It's just crazy.
Well, they extended them, although I remember this, and I always bring this up. There was 1 year that the Eagles had a bye week on week 17, and that was our championship weekend of our fantasy league. So the team that was in the championship game had to pick up a quarterback to cover for the Eagles bye, and they picked up Trent Dilfer, and they won the championship. So there you go. But it doesn't make much sense. We played a 16-week season and take a bye. I almost wish they could just do like a 4-week, 8 teams each week, but I know they want to spread out all the TV games because there wouldn't be anything left on TV. Yeah, it was painful because I was at home on Sunday and I was watching the Falcons and the Bucks, which was such a minor league JV game. It was just bad. So I'm like, I'm going to go to the sports bar and watch the Titans, but there'll be other games on. And the Titans were just so bad that it was rough. And it was like the Titans were on, and then it was the Jets and the Steelers. There was just not much good football going on early on Sunday. But this Sunday, I'm going to be in Nashville, so I need a place to watch the games. I was thinking of that Two Bits place in, downtown-ish.
Two Bits? Now, which one's that?
That's the place of all the old video games.
Oh, is that what it's called? Oh, okay. That was a cool place.
So I could play Space Invaders and, not watch the Titans because they're Monday.
Miss Pac-Man and Golden Tee had Golden Tee.
I mean, they had the old games. They can get the Nintendo 64, like Mario Kart, going, which is pretty awesome. They already asked Justin if he was going to go. He had something else going on. I'm like, oh, I'm just going to have to go there and take pictures and let you know. But yeah, full Nashville experience because I'll be coming in Saturday and leaving Tuesday. So yeah, I'll be around.
We must be taking a day off from work.
Yeah, it's lovely. I'm taking Monday and Tuesday off and Friday because I'm going up to Pigeon Forge for the family gathering. We just had to talk about, are we actually going to go to the Tennessee-Missouri game? Because the last time they played at like noon, and we got tickets really cheap at the last minute, and this time it's a night game, and it's going to be a little harder to get tickets, but it's going to be chilly. It's going to be a little bit chilly. In Tennessee, I don't know. I can't really. It's hard to speak. It's a bizarre time in Missouri football history. I'm sure soon enough the SEC East will catch up to all their 5-star recruiting classes and start pasting Missouri, as they should. So, how is fantasy life treating you?
Not too bad. The team that I have in my dynasty league is the Jake Locker that I had to play league. I pretty much sucked.
Oh, right. Brady was on a bye? Oh.
Yeah, Brady was on a bye. And, of course, Jimmy Garoppolo was on a bye as well, and I couldn't pick up a quarterback. And I was all the sads. I actually haven't had a chance to really check. I know I won. The league that I care about, I won. I'm doing really well in it. I was in first place. I lost a... Ugh. Anyway, so I did all right. I started Jordan Matthews over Justin Hunter.
Yeah, that was a good call. Yeah. Yeah, Monday night going in, I was leading by 20, and my opponent had the Eagles defense. And I'm pretty sure that only 4 times this year a defense has scored more than 20. The Eagles had 20-plus in the first half, so I was like, oh, good, I can turn this off. It was sad because I had Alshon Jeffrey on Sunday night, and I was like, well, at least I can get some garbage points from him, and he didn't really do much. And it's sad that the Bears have kind of circled the drain on offense.
Yeah, it really is. But, you know, I got Kelvin Benjamin garbage points, so I was happy.
Yeah, that was amazing. Like, I was before everybody had given up that. That's one thing I think that keeps the NFL ratings up, even though the games stink, is because of fantasy, all those points still count. And I had Kelvin Benjamin. I mean, I'm in this Fanium league where you can start 4 receivers, and I have Kelvin Benjamin, I have Mike Evans, so that really worked out nicely. But I do believe, yeah, I'm facing the team that has Ben Roethlisberger. So Monday night has been determining a lot of games for me lately. So it's not going to be pretty much the same again. Not going to say start your Titans. I think...
there is not a Titans skill player that you should start whatsoever.
Sounds like Delaney's done. He's out for the week, probably.
I don't expect him to play. He was knocked out, briefly knocked out, and it was a significant blow. And this is his second or third concussion, depending on how you interpret the first head injury that he had back when he was a San Francisco 49er. So, yeah.
Now, was that like an illegal hit that wasn't called? Because I've heard about that. I haven't actually seen the hit.
I do not think it was a legal hit. Was it a dirty hit? Subjective.
It was like a penalty worthy that wasn't called? It seemed like penalties weren't being called.
The face mask that they didn't call on Zach Mettenberger was... It was worse. It was like 10 times worse. That one was bad. But, I mean... He grabbed it and held on to it, and it wasn't, I mean, he held on to it for like 5 minutes, and the...
Yeah, that was one of those plays that, like, the Titans really needed something, and she's like, really? They didn't see that? Like, if Tom Brady or Peyton Manning, you guys probably kicked out, but, oh, it's a rookie. I think that happened to Vince Young some. He ran so much that he would get hit, and he would probably be a penalty for other guys, but never was.
Like Alex Smith?
Oh, Alex Smith.
If you remember the play that I'm talking about in last year's game, the Bernard Pollard hit.
Was that the one where he was like half a step out of bounds?
It was bull crap.
Anyway. It was basically the game-turning play because it was third down, and he was out. Like, he was running out of bounds short. Very Alex Smith kind of play. Didn't try to get the first down. And then the guy hit him, and it was very close, and they called a penalty. And I'm pretty sure they were winning at that point, and... Guess what they didn't do? They didn't win. But I don't know. We still suck for the duck? Are we still like, yeah, let's lose so we can get a high draft pick? Are you still like, no, let's win?
I was never on that bandwagon. I'm not. I like Mariotte. I'm not sure that he is what Ken Whisenhunt is looking for or wants. And I think that, I think that they have a lot of issues, and it's a toss-up on what they could do.
Yeah, I was wondering it. I mean, people are looking at the draft way in advance, and I probably should reach out to all the scout people that I know. Because I wonder, is there like that defensive end slash, outside linebacker guy that they need? Or maybe the Michael Griffin who actually plays like a guy who gets paid as much as Michael Griffin should, available. But then again... we'll see. Many months to go. So you could be at the game? All right, that'd be fun.
I think I'm going to be at the game. I'm going
to
make
a pink drink, but I need to get a loan approved before I can do that.
All the pink drinks we could want. I just spit on myself. I wonder if they still have pink drinks.
Well, so have you been to a game this year?
I have not been to a game this year.
Because they had some... more local beers. The only problem is they were like cash only. Actually, it wasn't a problem because if they were credit card, I probably would have bought like 7 of them. So I'm kind of glad.
Are you going to be double fisting Monday night? I just want to know.
I don't know. It's like my cousin's in town and he does drink a lot because he's an LSU fan, but his two sons are there, so that might keep him a little more calm. I do want to go home in one piece on Tuesday, so yeah, we'll see. Since we're all going to be hanging out Saturday through Monday, I'm not quite sure yet, but I'll be in town. We'll see how it goes,
Well, we'll have to hook up and chug some beers.
That's right. All right, Sharona, you tell them what you got going on. What's happening in the land of Sharona?
All right. Well, tomorrow on Game Over with Vasti and Sharona, we're going to have Brandon from Her Fantasy Football is going to talk some fantasy football with us. By the way, if you missed our interviews today, you should definitely check them out. We had Steve White and Reggie Walker, both great guys. excuse me, I'm going to lose my voice. And then on Friday, oh, we're going to have Dave back. Dave's going to be on our show on Friday from Steelers Depot talking about the big matchup Monday night. So I'm really anxious to talk to him again.
I know. He's quite knowledgeable. All right. Well, yeah, Sports by Sharona on the Twitters. You find her. Zach_Law, fantasysports.org is where to find me. I'm going to be writing about my auction league fantasy FSO League of Doom. How did an auction league go? And how's it going 10 weeks in? And we'll be, doing the usual nonsense. So, great to see everybody. Thanks for joining us for an extended version of Know Your Enemy and Going for Two. And let's have some fun. Primetime football, Titan style. I still have beer. What's going on with that? What's up with that?
I still have a little bit of beer, too. Hasta la vista, baby.
Adios.